Why live a normal life when you could be living the abundant life? Welcome to the Abundant Life Program with Ashley and Carly Terades.
Hello and welcome to the Abundant Life. We're so glad you've joined us today in the lounge. We've got a great program for you today. We're going to be looking at God's peace today. You know what? God's peace is powerful. God's peace can establish you. And I'm telling you, today we're going to learn about God's peace and about how you can have God's peace operating in your life, regardless of what circumstances you're going through. Amen?
Amen. You know, when I grew up in church, they'd often say, peace be with you.
Oh, yeah. Right? Peace be with you. Yeah.
Peace be with you. And they'd go through what do you call it?
The creed?
The creed, yes. Thank you.
Eulogy?
Something like that, anyway.
Church of England. They go and shake hands.
Yes.
Do all that
peace
stuff.
Be with you and also with you. They'd do that a lot.
We did that at the midnight Christmas service
this
year.
We did.
We was over in the UK and we went to a traditional service for Christmas Eve and they had candlelit service. Do you remember that?
Yeah, it was very nice.
The guy had long hair and he was sat in front of us.
Oh my goodness, the whole time I was totally distracted thinking that the flame from the candle was going to burn all the way up his golden locks to his head. And I probably missed much of the service.
The guy a few rows in front of us had long hair. He looked like a woman from the back. So this woman's
beautiful hair though.
Was almost touching the candle. So everyone was worried. But then we found out it was a man. It was like, well, if it burns, it burns.
Stop it.
Anyway, okay.
Sorry. This is a very serious teaching, actually. You're ruining
Peace
it.
Peace be with you.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Anyway, so growing up in church, back to my point, growing up in church, we used to say this, and I had no idea what this meant, right? I just thought, well, that's nice. You know, it's like greetings or something, you know? And my idea of peace was, well, this is just like a warm and fuzzy feeling. It's just like, you feel restful, you know? It's like, in my world where I grew up, it'd be the opposite of, you know, arguing or something. It'd be like everything was at peace.
Oh, peace, man.
Peace, man. Yeah. Right? That's not what this is talking about.
Okay.
That peace is not weak. It is not airy-fairy. It is not flowery. It's actually a very powerful force. So we're going to look at what this is because I think it's a little bit misunderstood. But the kind of peace that God has so many benefits. We really need to take time to break this down. So hopefully this is going to benefit you. I believe you're going to get something good from this. But let's look, first of all, in Isaiah 53. Okay, so Isaiah 53, many people will be familiar with this. It's a very famous passage of scripture. This is talking about the crucifixion of Christ before he was even born. But down in verse 4, I'm going to jump in here. It says, surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement for our peace was upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. So this is talking about the atonement of Jesus and everything that his death, burial and resurrection has paid for us. But you know, it would be wrong if we just move over this and we do not really come to understand what these words mean in the original text. It loses a lot of power in the English translation. This word in verse 5, bruised, he was bruised for our iniquities. That actually means to be beaten to pieces. So now you can imagine the crucifixion, if some of you have maybe seen Mel Gibson, The Passion of the Christ. Mm. I had to sit through that with my hand over my eyes most of the time.
It was pretty bad.
Because it was pretty gruesome, right? I think it's one of the only 18 movies I've watched, but it was hard to watch, even though, Mel Gibson says, if I was to depict that as it truly happened, no one would be able to watch it. Mm-hmm. They actually toned it down for the movie.
The real crucifixion was a ton worse than that.
Right. Mm. This word here, bruised, means to beaten to pieces. Jesus would have been unrecognizable.
Wow.
Unrecognizable. That's the power of the crucifixion here. But it says he did that for our iniquities, and the chastisement for our peace was upon him. This word peace in here is the word shalom. Shalom means more than just to be at peace, to be at rest, to be calm, to be still, okay? Or to be at peace with God. It actually means welfare, health, prosperity, peace, rest, safety, favor, wholeness, and friendship. All wrapped up into that one package. The peace of God has brought us into friendship with God. It has made us whole in our body. He has prospered us financially and in our souls. He has brought protection upon us, safety upon us. It has given us favor with God, favor with man, and a good understanding, right? It has given us health and welfare. It has made us completely whole. This isn't just like making you better when you're sick. This is making you whole as if you were created new. This is what shalom means. This is the peace of God. You see, when we have the peace of God operating in our life, all of these things come into play. So this isn't just something that we want to breeze over. You know, if you look in the New Testament, in Galatians 5:22, it lists peace as one of the fruits of the Spirit. We have peace in the fruit of our spirit. That means no matter what the situation is going on in life, it doesn't matter how much the storm is raging around us, we have peace as the fruit of our spirit. That means that is a supernatural ability to enter into a place of rest and peace in a time of crisis. That's a pretty cool gift, don't you think?
Amen. It's awesome.
Man, I mean, if we really start to get a grip of that and realize that we have the ability to walk in peace no matter what the situation, that's huge. You know, you were talking about this in one of our previous sessions, but we are a spirit, soul, and body.
Amen.
And oftentimes we just live in our flesh, right? We just operate out of our body, out of our soul, out of our mind, will, and emotions. Whereas in the inside of us, one third of us is spirit. That means this is where this fruit of the spirit in Galatians 5:22 comes from. You see, in our spirit, we have all joy, all love, all peace, all faithfulness, all self-control, all temperance. We have all of these things on the inside of us all of the time. So that means at any given point in the day, regardless of how our flesh is feeling, we can tap into any of those things in our spirit. We can tap into the peace of God and let it flow through us and out of us.
Amen. It's awesome. It's available to us.
And, you know, everyone.
It's not something we have to try and obtain or get. You know, if you're born again, you already have the peace of God on the inside of you. You already have it on the inside of you. You know, it's just down to you whether you want to walk in it, whether you're going to believe it and receive it and actually walk in it. Praise God. You know, this is Philippians. Philippians 4 verse 6, if you want to read along here, it says, "Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God." So he's saying here, Paul's saying here, you know what? Be anxious for nothing. So choose not to be anxious. You know, Jesus told his disciples, "Fear not." Now, if Jesus told you to do something, it's because you can do it. So by Jesus telling us to fear not, it means we can do it. So you can fear not. You can choose to be anxious for nothing. So be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication. So Paul's saying here, bring everything to God. Cast your cares, cast your burdens onto Jesus. Cast your cares onto God. Bring everything to God in prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. So be thankful to God. Bring thanksgiving to God. You know, make sure you're thankful for what you have. Let your request be known to God. And then verse 7 continues on. It says, "And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus." So what Paul's saying here is, you know, if you do these things, the peace of God is going to be, you're going to be walking in the peace of God. And that peace of God surpasses understanding, which means you could be in a situation, there's a terrible situation. You could be going through a trial. You could be going through a storm, but you still have the peace of God on the inside of you. You're not anxious. You're not fretting. You're not beside yourself. You have peace. And we've been there a number of times. You know, we've had peace operate in our life that surpasses understanding. We've been in trials that look terrible. And you think, you know what? In the natural, you should be fretting. In the natural, you should be super anxious. In the natural, you should be beside yourself. But God's peace, as we've walked in God's peace, and we've felt peace, and we've felt totally calm and totally at peace within ourselves, even though, you know, all hell's breaking loose, almost literally around us. We've had peace because we've done these things. We've actually activated the peace of God that we already have on the inside of us. As Christ said, Galatians 5:22 says, we have God's peace. We have peace as part of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. So we have peace. The question is, are you choosing to walk in that peace or not? And you can activate that peace by doing these things.
You know, it's interesting you should say that, because that word peace there in Galatians 5:22 is actually the Greek word irene. And it means to set at one again.
Wow, that's good.
In other words, to set back to its original position. To set at one again. Security, safety, prosperity. To keep safe, prosperous, and rest. To keep safe. When Jesus, this is in Mark 4:39, you know, it says, the wind and the waves came up, the storm came up. He said, "And he arose and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, 'Peace, be still.' And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm." Peace, be still. In other words, Jesus was setting right something that was wrong. You know, we can miss that. We can think, well, he was just calming the waves. No, there was more to it than that. He was setting to be at one again, to be right, to setting back to the original standard what was wrong with that storm. You see, that storm had whipped up, and it was endangering people's lives. It was endangering the disciples' lives. It was coming against the things of God. When we speak peace into a situation, there is something supernatural that happens, because what we're doing is we're setting at peace, we're setting right everything that is coming against the things of the kingdom.
That's powerful.
Man, that is That's powerful, good. Isn't it? This isn't just like, oh, well, I hope you feel better. Peace be with you. No, this is like, peace be with you, right? When we pray for people, often we'll speak peace into their flesh. Well, I speak peace to the cells in people's body. I speak peace to people's organs, peace to people's minds. And what we're doing is we're saying, organs, cells, you be as you were created to be. You will be set as one back to the beginning. Mm. As you were created to be, you be established according to God's word. That's what that means, right? To set back to the beginning, to be reset. You know, Isaiah 26:3, this is so powerful. Isaiah 26:3 says, he who keeps his mind stayed upon the Lord is kept in perfect peace, right? But I like what it says in the Message version of this. I've got it in my notes here because it's just easier. I don't have all the different Bibles.
This is the Message paraphrase.
Right, this is the Message paraphrase. And so Isaiah 26:3, verses 3 and 4 in the Message, it says, people with their mind set upon you, you keep completely whole.
That's good, isn't it?
Completely whole. This is exactly the same scripture. Remember, I just quoted it from the New King James. He who keeps his mind stayed upon the Lord is kept in perfect peace. Here in the Message, people who keep their mind set on you, you keep completely whole, steady on their feet, because they keep at it and they don't quit. Depend on God and keep at it, because in the Lord you have a sure thing.
That's good.
So I love that, because it's not just, you know, I'm in a bit of trouble, I'm in a bit of a pickle, I better ask God about the situation. It's to keep our mind steadfastly consumed with the things of the kingdom. And when it's almost like in a time of crisis, we have to brainwash ourselves with the truth.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is the peace of God, right? Yeah. The peace of God that surpasses all understanding will fill our heart and mind in Christ Jesus. And I just think that's neat. In 1 Corinthians 14:33, this is another good one. It says, God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. Confusion is not from God.
Amen.
If we find ourselves unsettled or anxious or worried about something, that's the absence of peace.
Yep.
Have you noticed you can't be in peace and worry at the same time?
Right.
You can't.
Yep. And you know, Paul talks about this again. This is back in Philippians. This is, I just read you Philippians 4, verses 6 and 7. But the very next verse, so verse 7, I'll read that to you again. It says, the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Then the next verse, verse 8, says, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. So Paul's saying, think on these things. Keep your mind stayed on these things. Just like Isaiah 26:3 says, keep your mind stayed on the Lord. Keep your mind stayed on these things. It says in verse 9, and the things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. You know what? We do these things and we're going to have peace that surpasses all understanding. We keep our mind stayed in the Lord, and God of peace is going to be with us. We're going to receive that peace. We're going to experience that peace. Again, we've already got it. It's just whether we're experiencing it or not. And sometimes, you know what? If you're going through a trial, if you're going through a challenge, it's very easy to let your mind wander. I've been there. I know. It's very easy to let your mind wander and just be fixated on the problem. Be meditating on that problem, be meditating on all the worst, and not only just the problem, you know what, we go beyond the problem. Our flesh and our carnal being and even the devil will have us even go beyond just the problem. We'll start thinking about what could happen.
We'll forecast the future.
We'll look at the worst thing. I've got this pain at the moment, and it's a pain, but it could be this and it could be that. And before you know it, you've gone, your emotions have run away with you. Now you've made something bigger than it really is.
Mm-hmm.
And your mind is actually stayed on these negative things. Paul's saying here, keep your mind stayed on these positive things. Keep your mind stayed on whatever's true, whatever's noble, whatever's a good report, cool, whatever's praiseworthy, and then you're going to experience peace. So we can release the peace of God in our life. We already have it, but you can release the peace of God in your life by the way you think. Your thinking is so important to keeping yourself in peace.
Mm.
You know, what we think on is going to be manifest in life. What we think on is going to be magnified. And I'm not telling you to ignore the facts. You know, some people get off in the other ditch and they just completely ignore the facts and say, I've got no issues, I've got no problem. I remember a friend of mine once, I said to him, how are you doing? And, you know, he's going on a mission trip. And I said to him, how are you doing financially? Oh, all my needs are met. And I said, so you've got your mission trip paid for? Yep, my mission trip is paid for.
You don't need any money then?
You don't need any money then? No, my mission trip's paid for. Then I found out afterwards, no, he still needed to raise like $1,000. What I was going to donate to him, I found out afterwards. I said, why didn't you tell me that? He said, well, I was in faith. I was just meditating on the good things, the good report. I wasn't focusing on the negative. And I was like, brother, there's a balance here. You should have told me the facts. You could have said, you know what? God's told me it's going to be paid for. I'm believing it's going to be paid for. The good report is it will be paid for. But right now, I'm still $1,000 short. Or I'm still waiting for that $1,000 to come in. So, and I could have helped him.
So in a sense, you were both right, because he was believing that God was going to supply all his needs. And God was supplying all his needs. He was trying to anyway, through you.
Through me.
Right?
But
he just didn't recognize it because...
Exactly. So sometimes we get off and some people say, you know, I haven't got anything wrong with me, and they're in searing pain, or they've got something physically wrong with them, you can tell. That's the fact. But the truth is, the truth trumps the facts.
Mm.
So you need to get back to the truth, get back to the word of God and say, what does God say about the situation? And meditate on those things. And that's what will keep your mind in peace when you start meditating on those things. It's a supernatural peace. We can experience a supernatural peace even in the worst case scenario, even in a bad situation.
You know, we use this example of Jesus calming the storm, but if you back up a little bit there in Mark 4, Jesus actually says in 4:35, on the same day when evening had come, he said to them, let us cross over to the other side. So he'd already told them that they were going to the other side, right? He'd already given them a directive. You know, in every word from God is everything we need to perform it. Just have to say that.
Yeah.
Verse 36, now when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was, and the little boats also with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat the boat so that the boat was already filling. But he was asleep in the stern on a pillow. He was at peace. You notice that?
Yeah.
Jesus was at peace. That's why he was sleeping. He wasn't worried about the storm. He was at peace. Because he'd already spoken the words, let's go to the other side. That means they were going to the other side. It didn't matter what happened between one shore and the other. It didn't matter the size of the storm. The fact was, he already knew the end result, and the end result was they were going to the other side.
So God's word was, we're going to the other side.
Yep.
The disciples had to believe in that word. If they, halfway through that storm, if they'd completely freaked out and jumped ship and, you know, drown or swam back to the other side, they wouldn't have seen God's word come to pass. Because they'd chosen not to believe it. They'd chosen to go in the opposite direction. So God's word, so that's the same as God's word telling us we're healed, God's word telling us we're prosperous, God's word telling us we're more than overcomers, God's word telling us we've got peace.
And this is exactly what the word peace settled when it said shalom in Isaiah 53. It settled all of those things. See, God spoke and his word is already settled in heaven. He's already spoken. We're going to the other side. These storms might arise, but we're going to the other side. We are more than conquerors. We are victorious. Amen. We are overcomers. We're already going to the other side. And Jesus already had that word settled in his heart. It didn't matter what happened in between here or there. It didn't matter the size of the storm and how scary it was and how much water filled the boat. He knew he was going to the other side because he rested in that word. He was able to be in peace.
That's why he could sleep while the boat was filling with water.
Right, because he placed more value on the word than he did on the circumstances. He didn't lose his peace just because a circumstance came along. You know, it says here, it carries on, it says, they woke him up anyway. He was sleeping, they woke him up. Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? You know, this is interesting. We've gone from, you know, it's a little bit windy to there's some water coming into the boat to surely we're going to die. Isn't that what we do? You know, when we get to forecasting, right? We go from A to B in like heartbeat, right? Because not only, you know, we may have started in a place of peace, but before we know it, we've started to look at the wind and the waves and thought, oh, actually, they are a bit scary. Therefore, the word of God can't be true. Oh, throw the Bible out the window, right? And then we start to get into fear and at peace is, where was peace then? It's gone. What Jesus did, he gets up and he says, he arose and rebuked the wind and the sea. Peace be still. And there was a great storm. And then he said, this is really interesting. Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? In other words, he was asking, where is your faith? Don't you realize that your faith's in the boat with you?
Mm.
Right? Man, we can be at peace because Jesus is in our boat. If nothing else, we have things here that the disciples didn't have. We have a Jesus that's always with us. He's not sometimes with us and sometimes not. Mm. We know we carry Jesus around on the inside of us wherever we go. We have the peace of God that lives and breathes on the inside of us 24/7. Man, God's word is settled forever in heaven, and we're carrying it around in us.
Amen. We have peace personified.
Peace personified.
We have the Prince of Peace living on the inside of us.
The Prince of Peace lives in us. That's huge.
As it is in heaven, so it is on earth. We can actually experience God's will on earth.
Amen.
And that's peace. Regardless of the circumstance.
Right. I'm just thinking, this is in Colossians 3, verse 2 and 3. It says, set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth, for you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. You see, we've been in Christed, right?
Amen,
we have Christ in us. We've been in Christed. We carry around peace. I like it how he writes this in the Amplified translation. It puts it this way. Set your mind and keep habitually focused, or focus habitually, on the things above, the heavenly things, not on the things that are on this earth, which are only of temporal value. They're going to pass away. For you died to this world, and your new life, your real life, is hidden with Christ and God. You see, peace is not just a place that we have to visit and then leave.
Yeah.
We can stay in this place of peace, regardless of the circumstances that are going on around us. We have the Prince of Peace on the inside of us. We can choose to tap into that peace at any moment that we want to. We can live in a place of peace. We don't have to be tossed around by the storms of life. Amen.
Right.
And that doesn't mean the storms of life aren't going to happen, but we're going to travel through them differently.
Amen. That's powerful.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's something that we have to be intentional, because if we're not intentional, then you know what? Our emotions, our flesh, our soul, our emotions will get to us, and before you know it, we'll be in strife and confusion, or you know, we'll be beside ourselves or anxious. That's easily done. So we have to be intentional of keeping our mind stayed on the Lord. We have to be intentional on keeping our mind on these things. And you know what? Praise God, we'll experience peace. Our spirits are always at peace. Our spirits are always calm, at peace. Our spirit is always rejoicing. But you know what? Our soul part of us, which is our mind, will, and our emotions, and our flesh, they can get out of control, especially when a challenge comes, especially when there's something that comes against us that seemingly could cause us an issue, that could cause a challenge. But you know, the important thing is live out your spirit. What does your spirit say? What does the Word of God say about you? What does God say about the situation? Praise God. And God sees you as victorious. God's always going to make a way out. God's always going to show you a way of escape. God's always going to lead you to triumph. You are more than conquerors through Christ. So you know what? We need to agree with the Word of God. You know, Amos 3:3 says, how can two walk together unless they agree? Well, start agreeing with what God says about the situation, and you're going to experience peace in that situation, even if it's all crazy around you.
You know, so how do we enter into this place of peace? How do we keep our mind stayed upon the Lord habitually? How do we do this? So Colossians 3:15 says, let the peace of God rule in your hearts. And that word rule actually means to umpire.
Mm.
So in other words, let the peace of God be the umpire over our hearts. You know, I think sometimes we lose our peace because we allow our mind and our thinking to be focused on things that are not of God.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's coming back to Isaiah 26:3 again, isn't it?
Right.
Keeping our mind stayed upon the Lord is what keeps us in peace. So we already have a position of peace, right? We have the peace. We have the Prince of Peace in us. We're not trying to get peace. We have peace on the inside of us, right? It's who we are in our nature. We don't have to try and work it up, right?
Yeah.
We don't have to try and get something we haven't got. We already have peace on the inside of us. But in order to tap into the peace that we have in our spirit man in Jesus, the battle is for our thought life.
Mm-hmm.
The battle is not with principalities and powers, right? It's not with demons and the devil. It's with our own mind, with our own thoughts. The battle for the peace to rule in our hearts begins in our thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
And so really it comes back to taking our thoughts captive, isn't it?
Amen.
And sometimes, judging them.
Sometimes it's the devil giving us those thoughts.
Maybe.
So I guess you can say we do war against principalities and the devil and stuff, but not in the way, a lot of the time people talk about that as we've got to go up and break the heavenlies with prayer and things like that. What we're talking about is the spiritual warfare really is going on in our minds. And you know what? Jesus had spiritual warfare in his mind. I mean, the devil tempted him three times, and three times he had to overcome the devil. And that was his thoughts. So the devil was giving him thoughts. Just turn this stone in, this is Luke 4, turn this stone into bread. or, you know, jump off the temple and God will save you, or bow your knee to me and I'll give you these kingdoms. You know, that was spiritual warfare. Jesus had to do spiritual warfare there in his mind. You know, he even had the thoughts of, you know, not going to the cross. And, you know, he battled those thoughts and he chose to think God's thoughts, his Father's thoughts, rather than his own thoughts. Even though Jesus was 100% God, he was also 100% man when he was on earth. So he had to battle his thoughts as well. He had to do this spiritual mm-hmm. warfare, if you like, in his thought life too. Mm-hmm. So bringing every thought captive to the obedience of Christ is really where it's at when it comes to walking in this peace permanently, walking in this mm-hmm. peace day to day. You know, mm-hmm. keeping our thought life under check, keeping our thought life. We can't just think on anything and then assume we're going to have peace.
Right.
If we think on the wrong things, Jesus says, be careful how you hear.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if we just think about anything all the time, then we're not going to experience God's peace all the time.
Philippians 4:8, meditate,
mm-hmm.
right? Meditate on, are things good? Are they noble? Are they of good report?
Mm-hmm.
Are they of virtue? Are they true? Are they lovely?
And we can choose right? to think on those things. That's our choice.
Choose.
That's
yeah.
our choice.
Yeah.
Praise God. God's peace is available and you can walk in God's peace. Whatever you're going through, you can walk in God's peace today. It's available to you and he wants you to walk in that peace, praise God. He doesn't want you to be anxious or in fear or have any type of worry or anxiety. He wants you to walk in peace. Praise God. So it's available to you. Amen.
Amen. Perfect. Amen. Perfect love casts out fear.
Amen.
Amen.
That's good. That's good. Well, we're nearly out of time, so we want to pray for you before we let you go. You know, thank you for joining us today. And, you know, make sure this sinks in. You have the peace of God on the inside of you,
Amen.
And you can choose to walk in that. Amen. So, Father God, I thank you for everyone watching today. Amen. I thank you for everyone listening. I thank you, Lord, you've given them peace. I thank you, Lord, they have your peace on the inside of them. And I thank you, Lord, every person is walking in that peace. I thank you, Lord, we're choosing what we're thinking on. And we're thinking on the good things. We're thinking on your thoughts. We're thinking on good things, on good reports. We're thinking on things that are praiseworthy. And I thank you, Lord, the peace of God that surpasses all understanding is taking over. And we're at peace, whatever the circumstance. I thank you, Lord, for people walking in supernatural peace today, right now in their situation. And I thank you, Lord, you're giving them the strength to do that. And I thank you, Lord, they have the ability to do that in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Amen. Praise God. That's awesome. Well, we'll be back real soon. But until next time, don't just live a normal life. You know what? You can live the abundant life. We'll see you next time.
To order your copy of this teaching, visit our website, TerraDesMinistries.com.
Hey, I want to thank the partners of TerraDes Ministries. Thank you for your support. You know what? By your financial support, we're able to go out and touch the world for Jesus. We're seeing people's lives turned around. We're seeing people healed. We're seeing people set free. We're seeing people born again. And your gifts are enabling us to do that. So we want to thank you and thank you on behalf of all the people we're touching, praise God. Thank you for your partnership. We appreciate you. We're praying for you. We know you're going to increase as you sow seed into this ministry. So we're praying for you regularly. Thank you for your partnership. We love you all.
We invite you to donate and partner with TerraDes Ministries. Visit our website, TerraDesMinistries.com, and become a partner today. Coming up next on the Abundant Life program.
What money does is it amplifies what's already in your heart. And if you are a mean person, mean-spirited, mm-hmm. and you just, you know, you're a hoarder and you don't like giving and things like that, when you have more money, you're going to do the same with that money. But when you're a giver and you love people and you want to help people and you're generous, more money is just going to make you more generous.